is the inflammation of the pancreas. IITs anywhere is inflammation. Can be acute or chronic. Clinically, it is difficult to differentiate between an acute pancreatitis and chronic pancreatitis. Chronic pancreatitis actually presents as acute episode, acute on chronic pancreatitis. Clear? So, there is no hard and fast rule, like less than 2 weeks. Usually we say less than 2 weeks it is acute, more than 2 weeks is chronic, or less than 6 weeks is acute, greater than 6 weeks is chronic. That hard and fast rule is not here, not applicable here. Clear? Right? How does this pancreatitis set in? What happens is, you know, trypsinogen. Clear? You know what is a zymogen granule. I can't go into the details. So, pancreatic enzymes will be in an inactive state when they are within the pancreas. Okay? They will be protected, they will be inactive. When, during the process of digestion, when the chyme comes from the stomach into the duodenum, okay, because of acidity, what happens? Stimulation of secretion, secretin, cholecystokinin and other gut hormones will start. So, at that process, the pancreatic secretions, pancreas is both exocrine as well as endocrine. Exocrine is secreting digestive juices. It can digest carbohydrates, it can digest proteins, it can digest fat. Clear? Right? Endocrine, islet cells of Langerhans. Most common, insulin we are concerned with, alpha, beta and all that, somatostatin secretion. So, beta cells secreting insulin, both functions. So, pancreas will now secrete the enzymes into the duodenum. Okay. Now, it becomes activated, the enzymes becomes activated and they start the process of digestion. What happens in pancreatitis is, this enzyme activation will occur prematurely within the pancreas. Right? Why does this occur prematurely? Because of the concept of colocalization. Slide changes. Colocalization. What is colocalization? The zymogen granules and the lysozyme both will be localized together. Right? Because of this colocalization, when will it happen? It can happen because of an insult. Insult in the form of a gallstone, insult in the form of a trauma, insult in the form of a alcohol, or sometimes no cause identifiable, idiopathic. Right. So, colocalization will cause the premature activation of the enzymes. Because of the premature activation of the enzymes, what happens? This enzymes will digest, auto-digestion of the pancreas. This causes pancreatitis. Right. In molecular level, if we have to say, there will be activation of caspases. You know what are caspases in pathology. Right. These caspases, what they will do is, they will recruit inflammatory cells, pro-inflammatory as well as anti-inflammatory, interleukin 1, tumor necrosis factor 6, they will be recruited. Anti-inflammatory cells will also be recruited. Now, there should be a balance between the pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory. But in pancreatitis, what happens? Because of the insult or because of unknown reasons, there will be increased pro-inflammatory activity, because of which macrophages, neutrophils, platelets, all the chemotactic agents will come. They will start secreting different enzymes, different products like cytokines, growth factors, platelet-derived growth factors, right, prostaglandins, all these will be secreted. So, because of all these enzymes, there will be an inflammatory cascade. This inflammatory cascade will turn into CIRS. What is CIRS? Systemic inflammatory response syndrome, right? From the pancreas, the inflammation will spread throughout the body. Systemic inflammatory response syndrome, right? If suppose the anti-inflammatory mechanisms are unable to control CIRS, systemic inflammation, the CIRS will progress into MODS. What is MODS? Excellent. Multi-organ dysfunction syndrome. And multi-organ, different organs, liver, kidney, all these can be damaged, lungs, right? So, at the level of MODS, the mortality will be 30%. Clear? 100 patients presenting with acute pancreatitis, if suppose they become severe pancreatitis, there will be 30% risk of death. Usually what happens is, the anti-inflammatory cascade will control this. Meanwhile, we also give some support in the form of IV fluids and ICU and all that. We'll see in the treatment. So most of the attacks of pancreatitis are mild. Only few are severe. In the severe, the mortality is 30%, while in mild group it is about 1 to 5%. Clear? That is the molecular level of pancreatitis. Now, risk factors. Just now I have disclosed. Most common cause of acute pancreatitis, excellent, gallstones. Most common cause of chronic pancreatitis, alcohol. That is the difference. We think alcohol for both, but for acute it is gallstones. Now, each and every cause we will see just briefly. Gallstones. Fertile female 40, you all know about gallstones. Right? What happens? This gallstone can block ampulla of Waiter. Pancreas will secrete the juices into the pancreatic duct. This pancreatic duct should open into the second part of the duodenum. But at ampulla there is an obstruction. Stone is there. So what happens? There will be pancreatic duct hypersecretion, pancreatic duct hypertension. Okay. Enzymes will now become activated within pancreas, cause pancreatitis. Clear? Sometimes what happens? There is a common channel. CBD will come, pancreas will come, both pancreatic duct will come, both will form a common channel for 1 cm and then they open into ampulla. Suppose what happens if the obstruction is at ampulla, bile can sometimes reflux back into the pancreas. Okay, because there is obstruction, this pancreatic duct is patent, so it will reflux back. It can cause pancreatitis. So by two mechanisms, the gallstones can cause pancreatitis. Clear? Alcohol. Alcohol, what does it do? The most important mechanism by which alcohol causes pancreatitis is activation of nuclear factor kappa B pathway, NF kappa B pathway. Don't be frightened, just remember, activation of nuclear factor kappa B. What does this nuclear factor kappa B do is, it will start a pro-inflammatory cascade. See, alcohol has indirectly pushed the main button, NF kappa B. This NF kappa B is doing all the damage work by activating pro-inflammatory cascade. This alcohol can cause, second mechanism, can cause decreased vascularity of the pancreas, hypoperfusion of the pancreas. So whenever there is a hypoperfusion, there will be ischemia, because of which pancreatitis can be triggered. Okay. So that is why whenever patient presents with shock or intraoperative hypotension, there can be chance of pancreatitis. Okay, two mechanisms. One is nuclear factor kappa B activation and pro-inflammatory cascade. Another is decrease the vascularity of pancreas. This alcohol can cause accumulation of proteins within the pancreatic duct. It forms protein plugs within the pancreatic duct. Again, same mechanism, just like a CBD stone obstruction. Sometimes what this alcohol will do is, it will cause spasm of sphincter of Oda. Okay. Which drug you know causes sphincter of Oda? That is why we are afraid to give sometimes, but it is not true, you can give actually. Morphine. Morphine will also cause spasm. That is why we usually stop giving morphine in pancreatitis, but best painkiller in pancreatitis is morphine. Okay. So, understood the mechanism of alcohol? So, gallstones over, alcohol over. Next. Just like stone obstructing the pancreatic duct, there can be a tumor. Pancreatic cancer can cause obstruction to the pancreatic duct and cause pancreatitis. Or cancer in the CBD, hilar cholangiocarcinoma, distal hilar cholangiocarcinoma, can obstruct CBD and cause pancreatitis. Okay. Or another obstructive lesion is pancreatic division. What is pancreatic division? What is annular pancreas? Both are same, both are different. Good. Both are different. Division, D. D refers to duct. Annular, something related to circle or rotation. So, developmental defect. Annular pancreas is a developmental defect, while pancreatic division is associated with duct pathology. See, what happens is, there is a major duct and a minor duct. What is major duct? Virsung or Santorini? Major. M, you reverse it. Virsung. Major duct is Virsung. Minor duct is Santorini. Right? This major duct usually drains most of the pancreas. There are two openings. One is minor papilla and another is major papilla at ampulla, second part of duodenum. Minor papilla is little proximal, while distal to it is a major papilla, right? At the major papilla, the major pancreatic duct will open, right, draining most of the pancreas, while this minor duct Santorini will drain lesser area of the pancreas and it will open at the minor papilla. Minor papilla, as the name suggests, is small, right. In pancreatic division, what happens is most of the pancreas is drained by Santorini, right, not by Virsung. That is a abnormality. So what happens? Most of the juices are drained with through narrow opening. Minor papilla is smaller than major. So that is why there can be obstruction in pancreatic division, D related to duct. So minor duct draining most of the pancreas is pancreatic division, right? Coming through minor papilla. But what is annular pancreas? It can also cause pancreatitis, rotational deformity, right? Pancreas develops from two buds, dorsal bud and ventral bud. So imagine an aorta or IVC, something in the midline, suppose. Okay. So dorsal bud is towards left side, normal place of pancreas. Ventral bud is towards right side. From the ventral bud only there comes a hepatic bud, develops into hepatic structures. During the process of embryogenesis, there will be intestinal rotation. Bowels will come through the umbilicus outward. Again, they have to rotate back and go in. Suppose the rotation fails and bowels are outward, what do you call that? Exomphalus, omphalocele. But again, differences are there, right? So during that process of division, this ventral bud will turn and fuse with the dorsal bud and forms the pancreas. Failure of rotation of this ventral bud to fuse with the dorsal bud will cause annular pancreas. This becomes stuck around second and third part of duodenum like an arc. So it causes duodenal obstruction. Also, sometimes if duodenal obstruction can manifest in infancy, sometimes what happens is obstruction may not be evident. Patient comes in adult stage with pancreatitis. So pancreatic division, annular pancreas, both are obstructive causes. Clear? Apart from all these causes, iatrogenic causes of pancreatitis. Suppose you are doing gastrectomy. Where is pancreas to stomach? In the stomach bed posteriorly, right? Stomach is there posteriorly to the stomach. In the gastric bed, there is pancreas. You are doing gastrectomy. So you will be in and around pancreas. Suppose you are doing splenectomy. Spleen and tail of pancreas are related. Splenectomy. You are doing some duodenal surgery, perforation, duodenal perforation is there. Most common site of ulcer, peptic ulcer, good, duodenum. Which ulcer perforates, which ulcer bleeds? Anterior ulcer perforate, posterior ulcer bleed. Why does a posterior ulcer bleed? Because posterior wall of duodenum, posterior to posterior wall of duodenum, there is gastroduodenal artery. This ulcer will erode into the gastroduodenal artery, right? AP, you remember, Andhra Pradesh, anterior ulcers will perforate. Okay. Clear? Why we have gone there suddenly? Yes. We are iatrogenically, what we are doing is, we are doing any surgery in and around pancreas, it can trigger pancreatitis. That is what I want to say. Even you do liver resection, even you do cholecystectomy, there is chance of pancreatitis, clear? And apart from surgery, there is a procedure called ERCP. What is ERCP? Endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreaticography. It is similar to upper GI endoscopy. I know most of you know this, but again, for one minute I will repeat. When you go till to the second part of duodenum and stop, it is upper GI endoscopy, clear? From there, you need a flexible endoscope to visualize the ampulla. Ampulla is difficult to visualize. You need a flexible scope from there. So if you can get a flexible scope, enter the ampulla, dilate the sphincter and you stent the pancreatic duct and the CBD through the ampulla. Keep a stent or give a contrast through the ampulla. What happens? This contrast will go from the ampulla to common channel. From the common channel, it will go into pancreatic duct one way and common bile duct. From the common bile duct, it will reverse back to, please wake him up here, into right and left duct. So all the ductal pathology can be seen in ERCP. So ductal pathology is well delineated in ERCP, right? Whenever you do ERCP, what happens is there is increased risk of 1 to 5% risk of pancreatitis. So iatrogenic causes surgery and ERCP. Another cause is trauma. Always trauma for everything. Clear? Trauma can cause pancreatitis. Most common cause of pancreatitis in children. Trauma. Children don't drink alcohol usually, right? So, no gallstones. We are now discussing trauma. So, obviously, most common cause will be trauma. Okay. What else? Some, what you call snake venoms. Snake venoms. Right? Any poisonous substances. Drugs. So, there is a slide on drugs which cause pancreatitis. Trauma, biliary disease, gallstones, pancreatic duct obstruction, scorpion venom, drugs. Please remember the drugs, right? Estrogens, isoniazid. Definite question, which of the following drug will not cause pancreatitis? This I have told you, right? Apart from all these causes, there is an entity called as hereditary pancreatitis. Hereditary pancreatitis. This is most relevant to chronic pancreatitis. Right? Two things you have to remember in hereditary pancreatitis. There is a gene called as cationic trypsinogen gene. You know, trypsinogen is an enzyme of the pancreas. Right? So, this trypsinogen should be secreted in more quantity, or this trypsinogen should be prematurely activated within pancreas to cause pancreatitis. Okay. This cationic trypsinogen gene defect will cause more secretion of trypsinogen in the pancreas and hence cause pancreatitis. Right. There is another gene called as SPINK gene. SPINK. What does this SPINK gene do is serine protein inhibitor kinase. SPINK actually stands for. This SPINK gene product will inhibit trypsinogen activation. Premature activation of trypsinogen will be inhibited by this SPINK gene. Okay. Suppose if there is a loss of function in SPINK gene, suppose SPINK gene function is lost, what happens? Even normal amounts of trypsinogen will become active within the pancreas and can cause pancreatitis. Clear? So, usually hereditary pancreas, if they ask you, you remember cationic trypsinogen gene. SPINK gene is more related to idiopathic pancreatitis or tropical pancreatitis. So, genetic defect, if they ask you in tropical pancreatitis, you opt for SPINK gene. Clear? Two genes just you remember, cationic trypsinogen gene and SPINK gene. Right? Tropical pancreatitis, as the name suggests, is most commonly seen in tropics, most common in India, southern India, our part, right? So, why? Because of the SPINK gene. Even in idiopathic cases, you can trace the cause to SPINK gene. Clear all the causes? So, suppose no cause is known, idiopathic, or you can also say miscellaneous, right? Remember all the causes from gallstones, alcohol, surgery, iatrogenic, ERCP, obstruction in the form of malignancy or stone, right? Pancreatic division, annular pancreas, toxic products, right? Hypotension or shock, ischemia, and just now I have told trauma. All these are causes of pancreatitis. Clear? Now, how does a pancreatitis, acute pancreatitis patient present? So, you are still in final year. Actually, when you do your internship, you will be seeing lot many cases, especially at night time. Patient will drink alcohol and come with burning type of pain in the epigastrium. It mimics gastritis. Even you treat with Pantop initially, forgetting about pancreatitis, right? The typical pain of pancreas is in epigastrium. Pancreatitis is in epigastrium, radiating to back. So, leaning forward, pain decreases. That is a typical history, but typical history may not be evident. Any alcoholic patient comes with epigastric pain. Gastritis and pancreatitis should be a differential. Clear? So, apart from pain, I told you pancreatitis patient can also present with severe pancreatitis, right? In severe pancreatitis, what is happening? There is systemic inflammatory response syndrome. There is fluid sequestration, because of which patient can present with shock or multi-organ dysfunction syndrome in the form of what happens? Lungs, ARDS, kidneys, ARF, acute renal failure, ARDS, right? So he can present with organ failures, right? So that is a presentation. Nausea and vomiting, all that routine things will be there. Don't worry about that. So now you have seen a patient presenting with pain, typical history, radiating back, he is in hypotension. Now how do you manage such a patient? Provisional diagnosis is acute pancreatitis. Differential diagnosis is gastritis, cholecystitis or hepatitis, any upper abdominal pathology. Okay, how do you treat? How do you treat, yeah? Patient is in shock. First thing you have to give is secure a wide bore IV cannula, dump IV fluids. So isotonic fluids, normal saline, okay, and for confirmation, what do you do? Suppose patient is in ARF, you will catheterize the patient. He is also in shock, you will catheterize the patient to know the urine output. ARDS you are suspecting, you will keep oxygen, right? So major complaint of the patient is pain, you have to give analgesia. All these things you have done, over, your initial management is over. Now you have to go for a, after doing initial management, you have to assess what is in there, you want a proof. So what is the first thing you do is, you get a serum amylase and lipase test, right? Out of amylase and lipase, lipase is more specific to pancreas, right? Amylase is seen in multiple disorders. So can you name some disorders where amylase is elevated apart from pancreatitis? Salivary gland inflammations, right? Idiopathic rise in amylase, you call it as hyperamylasia, right? Salivary gland inflammation, mesenteric infarction, mesenteric infarction, any upper GI bleed, right? Torsion, it can be ovarian torsion or torsion of any organ, torsion. Whenever vascularity is compromised, whenever there is a torsion, whenever there is an inflammation, there can be a increased amylase. Okay, peptic ulcer perforation, just now we discussed. Again with P, pelvic inflammatory disease, ectopic pregnancy. Okay, all these are causes of elevated amylase. Apart from pancreas, if they ask you where it is seen, salivary gland inflammation, idiopathic hyperamylasia and peptic ulcer perforation, pelvic inflammatory disease, ectopic pregnancy, torsion, upper GI bleed, retroperitoneal hematoma, all these are causes of, excellent, increased amylase levels, right, which is sensitive to pancreatitis but not specific, right? Sensitive is different, specific is different. It is only 70% specific, while lipase is 90% specific. 90% lipase is also sensitive to pancreatitis. Clear? So whenever there is an attack of pancreatitis, immediately within 4 to 6 hours there will be a elevated amylase levels, right? These amylase levels will remain elevated for 3 or 4 days, 3 days, 72 hours, and then they will decline. Okay, lipase levels are slow to elevate. So whenever patient comes to you with pancreatitis or the midnight, if you do lipase, it may be normal. Lipase takes time to elevate, maybe 24 hours to 48 hours, sometimes 48 hours to 72 days. After elevation, after 2 to 3 days, by the time amylase will drop down, lipase will rise. So lipase rise will be sustained more than amylase. That is why lipase is more specific and more apt. If the patient comes to you lately, do it, do more, there is a more reliability over lipase. Now this is for acute pancreatitis. What happens in chronic pancreatitis? Can you see the same pattern? Chronic pancreatitis. Chronic means what? There are repeated attacks of acute pancreatitis repeatedly. So because of the repeated attack, what happens? What happens? There will be destruction of pancreatic cells. okay, in the place of pancreatic cells, because of the destruction, anywhere, any tissue which is destroyed, what happens? Excellent, fibrosis. So fibrosis of the pancreas is there. No parenchyma to produce enzymes. Parenchyma should produce, right? SNR cells should produce, right? No parenchyma. So what happens? Lipase and amylase may not be elevated in chronic pancreatitis. Not always, but there is a possibility that even amylase and lipase are normal, still it can be a case of pancreatitis. It can be a chronic pancreatitis. Just remember that. Okay. Fine. So patient is there in casualty. You have treated the patient with IV hydration, analgesia, catheterized the patient, kept him oxygen or ventilation, right? You are monitoring the urine output and all that you have done. Now you have done amylase and lipase. Now you want to see the pancreas. How do you see the pancreas? You have to image. What is the imaging modality of choice for pancreatitis? CT scan of the abdomen. Suppose in the options only CT is there, you opt CT. Suppose plain CT as well as contrast CT both are there, you opt for contrast CT scan of the abdomen. CT scan of the abdomen is the imaging of choice. So suppose if 100 patients come to you, you will do CT scan in all the 100 patients? You will get money. The problem with CT scan is it is radiation, radiation exposure. And most of the pancreatitis are mild, 70 to 80% are only mild, only 10 to 15% are severe. So, CT is indicated only in specific conditions. What are the conditions where CT is required? Number one, whenever patient presents with shock, whenever there is ARF or ARDS, what does this mean? Organ failure. Whenever patient is in shock or whenever there is organ failure, that means these two will be seen in severe pancreatitis. So whenever patient is presenting with severe pancreatitis, then you have to do CT scan of the abdomen. And what other indications where you do CT is whenever there are local complications of the pancreas. What are the local complications? There are local complications, there are systemic complications. Systemic complications, to the lung you call it as ARDS, to the kidney you are calling as ARF and all that. Now, what are the local complications of pancreatitis? Local complications is whenever there is an inflammatory cascade, there can be a fluid formation. Okay, this fluid formation is known as acute fluid collection. Fluid that is formed immediately during the inflammatory cascade is acute fluid collection. Right? What is the difference between a pseudocyst and a true cyst? Pseudocyst will not have a epithelial lining, right? But what is the lining for the pseudocyst? When there is no epithelium, it should be lined by something. It is lined with granulation tissue, right? A true cyst will be lined by a epithelium. Now, what does this acute fluid collection is lined by? Acute fluid collection is not lined by granulation or not lined by epithelium. Is just a collection in the space. Wherever there is space during the process of inflammation, there can be fluid collection. You call it as a acute fluid collection. It is temporary. If suppose the insult remains, pancreatitis is not treated, suppose it remains, this acute fluid collection may not resolve. So what happens? It can slowly increase in size. It can form a granulation layer. Now you call it as a excellent. So the process of formation of a pseudocyst from an acute fluid collection will take 4 weeks. So you are not supposed to call fluid collection as pseudocyst until 3 to 4 weeks are lapsed from the time of attack of pancreatitis. Till that time, especially for the first 2 weeks, you should call it as an acute fluid collection. Say suppose this acute fluid collection, instead of forming a granulation, is now infected. What does that become? Excellent, abscess, pancreatic abscess. Clear? So local complications, acute fluid collection, if it develops a granulation, you call it as a pseudocyst. If it becomes infected, you call it as a pancreatic abscess. Oh, in the pancreatitis, there will be destruction of pancreatic parenchyma. So destruction means death or necrosis. Okay. So another complication is pancreatic necrosis. This pancreatic necrosis can be sterile or infected. Sterile necrosis. Only death of the pancreatic tissue, no infection. You call it as a sterile necrosis. Right? Infected necrosis, apart from the death of the tissue, there is also infection. Clear? Now, what other complication can be there apart from this? Pancreatic enzymes are secreted from the pancreas to the surrounding structures. Pancreatic enzymes are rich in lipase, elastase and all these substances. They will eat away the tissues. So, there will be fat saponification. Diffuse fat saponification will be there. And suppose blood vessels, the lining of the blood vessels, adventitia, they act on the blood vessels, what can happen? They will eat up the blood vessels. There can be a torrential hemorrhage. Or sometimes there can be a formation of an aneurysm. This aneurysm, you call it as a pseudo aneurysm, not true aneurysm. Okay. So, all these are complications. What else can happen? Apart from getting loculated to a particular entity, the pancreatic fluid can spread whole of the abdomen. You call it as? Excellent. Pancreatic ascites. Ascites, pancreatic ascites. Suppose pancreas is more towards the left side. So, there can be left pleural effusion. Okay. All these are complications, systemic complications. If it goes to the lungs and other organs, systemic. If it is localized to the pancreas, it is local complication. Right. Severe pancreatitis is either having shock or systemic complications or local complications. Right. Mild pancreatitis will not have even local complications. Most of the acute pancreatitis are mild. They resolve by themselves. Okay. There is no role of antibiotic in acute pancreatitis when you suspect it is mild. Only when there are local complications or systemic complications, there is role of antibiotic. Suppose if there is necrosis, infective necrosis, then you have to treat the patient with antibiotics. Clear? I will again tell the treatment, don't worry. So, we are there at ultrasound of the CT scan of the abdomen is the imaging of the choice. And ultrasound of the abdomen, what is the problem with doing ultrasound of the abdomen for pancreas? Anteriorly, there are bowels, intestine, gas will be there. Gas is the enemy to ultrasound. So, pancreas may not be visible in the ultrasound. Best investigation is always a. Now, if you do a plain x-ray in acute pancreatitis, this only importance to the bits, this x-ray. We don't do usually x-ray. Right? So, what happens? What are the signs typical of acute pancreatitis? So, what is the bowel that is there here? Excellent. Super. Transverse colon. Right? Here you have hepatic flexure, splenic flexure. Because of spasm, what happens is the splenic flexure and the hepatic flexure will cut off, will contract. Say suppose in our terms you contract. So, what happens? Colon cutoff sign. Gas will be seen and sudden cutoff of the colon. Colon cutoff sign. Right? Because of pancreatitis, there can be paralytic ileus. Right? You can have an air fluid level in the x-ray. That air fluid level in the x-ray because of pancreatitis is known as sentinel loop sign. So, what are the signs? Colon cutoff sign, sentinel loop sign, and renal halo sign. Just remember the three signs in x-ray of the pancreas. Okay. Any other investigations you would like to do in this acute pancreatitis? What about ERCP? You want to do ERCP in acute pancreatitis? ERCP itself causes acute pancreatitis. So, are we justified to do a ERCP in acute pancreatitis? We are justified in doing ERCP in acute pancreatitis. Why and when? Right? ERCP should not routinely be done. Whenever there is a CVD obstruction, most common cause of pancreatitis, acute gallstones. So, thus this obstruction can be in ampulla of water or in the pancreatic duct. By doing ERCP, you can remove the stone or you can stent the strictured pancreas, if you are sure that the cause of pancreatitis is because of biliary, okay, then you can do ERCP. Or patient having cholangitis, right? What is the triad in cholangitis? Jaundice. What is the triad called? Excellent. Charcot's triad, right? Cholangitis. So when we are supposed to do a ERCP, number one is CBD obstruction, right? Whenever there is cholangitis, when you are sure that gallstone is the cause, whenever it is pancreatic duct is strictures, so that you can stent it and open, the juices will come, pancreatitis is resolved. Okay. Suppose patient cannot be taken for surgery, very old patient, in those patients also you can do ERCP. Okay. ERCP is not definitive to treat pancreatitis. Why? For treating gallstone pancreatitis. Why? Because you are removing the gallstone. What is the source of gallstone? Gallbladder. Big question, huh? Gallbladder. So you have to remove the gallbladder so that further attacks of pancreatitis are prevented. So to remove the gallbladder, you have to do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy. When you have to do this laparoscopic cholecystectomy in pancreatitis? At the same admission, right? Patient comes to you with pancreatitis. You have done an ultrasound. Ultrasound has shown gallstone, CBD stone, or a pancreatic duct stone. Then what you can do? You can do a ERCP. First, remove the stone, CBD stone or the pancreatic stone, whatever it is you have removed. If it is strictures, you dilate and leave. The next day or within 48 hours, you can do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy. Right, whenever the patient comes to you with mild attacks, but the cause is gallstones. Clear? So most of the gallstones, mild attacks, will pass off spontaneously. That is why you don't need a ERCP, or you don't need a stone, or you don't need a surgery at that time. Right? So we are unable to decide what is the cause, because stone is not seen, because it is being passed off. Clear? The stone is seen, definitely you have to do a ERCP, remove the stone, and then do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy if it is mild. If the patient comes to you with severe pancreatitis in shock or in some renal failure, we are not justified in doing the surgery at the same admission. What we will do? We will do a ERCP, remove the stone, hydrate the patient, give antibiotics, ask the patient to go home and come after 6 weeks. So interval cholecystectomy we will do. If it is a case of severe pancreatitis, do a ERCP at the same admission, send the patient home, ask him to come back after 6 weeks, and then you do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy, remove the gallbladder. If suppose CBD stones are there, you have to also explore for CBD stones. Laparoscopic CBD exploration or open CBD exploration with T-tube drainage. All that you can do. Okay, understood? So we can do ERCP even though it carries risk. That is the point that I want to convey to you. Clear? So all these are risk factors we have discussed, clinical features we have discussed. Now, apart from amylase and lipase, what other blood investigations we have to do? Right, we will see in Ranson's criteria. In pancreatitis, for our understanding, pancreas is damaged. So what happens to insulin? There will be temporary shutdown of insulin. Whenever there is insulin drop is there, what happens to blood glucose levels? So pancreatitis is associated with hyperglycemia. Okay, first point. Next point, there is fluid sequestration. Right, patient is in shock. Okay, what happens to hematocrit? Whenever there is fluid sequestration initially, hematocrit will appear to rise because there is fluid loss. But gradually what happens? It falls. Because it is not true rise, it is pseudo rise, it falls. So finally there will be fall in hematocrit. So what happens to oxygenation in pancreatitis? Lungs are affected, oxygenation will be decreased. So it is inflammation. What happens to WBC count? Excellent. What happens to liver enzymes? I mean AST, ALT, LDH. Any inflammation, usually there can be increased counts. Clear? Now we have just discussed lipase or elastase will damage the fatty tissue. Saponification. So at saponification, what happens is calcium goes and deposits, because of which there can be hypocalcemia. Clear? All these are abnormalities in pancreatitis. So all these are abnormalities are put into a criteria to decide whether it is severe or mild attack of pancreatitis. This criteria is known as a Ranson's criteria. I will show you now. Okay. Apart from Ranson's criteria, we also have Glasgow scale. This is not Glasgow coma scale. There is a Glasgow scale of pancreatitis, almost similar to Ranson's score. Just what he will do is, at the time of admission, two things are changed to after 48 hours. Right? From the down, he will bring two things up. Very similar to Ranson's. Just remember the name. There is a Glasgow score of pancreatitis. You need not remember what are the parameters in Glasgow. Just remember the same parameters which are there in Ranson's will be there in Glasgow. So remember Ranson's. Ranson's is most important bit. Right? Ranson's criteria, Glasgow score. Then you have Atlanta criteria. To be more exact, we call it as modified Atlanta criteria. Right? In modified Atlanta criteria, he has taken this Atlanta criteria is given to know whether it is a mild pancreatitis or severe pancreatitis. We have already discussed. In severe, what happens? There will be either systemic complications or local complications. So this Atlanta criteria has taken two things: local complications, systemic complications. If they are present, he says it is severe pancreatitis. We will see Atlanta criteria also. Next, we have CT severity index in pancreatitis. Based on CT findings, Balthazar has classified pancreatitis into different grades based on whether necrosis is present or not. Pancreatic necrosis is present or not. Pancreatic necrosis is not there, score is 0. If pancreatic necrosis is present for 30% of whole of the pancreas, less than 30% of whole of the pancreas, score is 2. It is about 30 to 50%, score is 4. Greater than 50%, score is 6. I will also show you that CT severity index. And another index is Apache score. What is Apache? A, acute. P, physiology. Acute physiology of chronic health evaluation score. Apache score. Acute physiology and chronic health evaluation score. Right? It takes different parameters, many parameters, and then it keeps a score to the patient whether he is fit, healthy or ill. That is Apache score. Just remember one thing in Apache: score greater than 8 is severe. Score greater than 8 is severe. Okay.